Well, good morning and happy Easter to all of you. Thank you. Welcome to Cold Harbour Church. It's our Easter morning service. My name's Phil. I'm one of the leadership team here. Later, our pastor Joshua will be speaking. If you've got children with you, there'll be some things set up for children during the sermon later on. We'll tell you about that when it happens. If there's anyone who's feeling uncomfortable, any children who are feeling uncomfortable, then I think I'm looking around, I don't think we're going to have any real screamers here, but we say if anyone really wants to scream, they could. There's a room over there you can go to, but anyway, the stewards will point you in the right direction. There's always things going on here. This evening we've got our Easter praise service, so do come out to that if you can. Tomorrow, we're going on a ramble to Trosley Country Park, I think. And so if you would like to join us for that, that would be really lovely. Speak to Roger about it. We'll meet here, 9:30, or at the park, if you know where it is, at 10 o'clock. And Roger says you can park down the entrance, down the road to the car park to save yourself the parking fee. But anyway, there you are. That's tomorrow. We normally have a lot of stuff going on through the week, but because it's the holidays, the normal things that go on aren't happening. But if you're interested in them, do ask me or someone else about them. And next Sunday, we've got after the morning service, we've got Jamie and Michaela are here working in France. And so because they're here, we're going to meet, have a lunch together. Bring and share lunch after the morning service and get a bit of a catch up on what they've been doing. And for those of you who are regulars here, you'll know that they've got new plans for the future and they'll be able to share some new stuff with us about what's going to be happening from September onwards. Okay, thank you. 2 days ago, Good Friday, five churches met together just down the road, and we're churches who are united by our love for Jesus, our knowledge of the truth that's given in the Bible. And we celebrated the day that Jesus died and was buried. His agonizing death was a punishment, but it wasn't a punishment for anything he had done, because he had never done anything wrong. He died to take the punishment that I deserve, and that we all deserve if we have ever done anything wrong. I asked some of the people yesterday at a service, the care home, had they done anything wrong? And Jen, you were there, weren't you? There's one lady who was absolutely insistent she'd never done anything wrong. And then when we questioned her a bit more afterwards with a smile on our face, she almost immediately admitted. So, yeah, we know, don't we, that we are wrong. We're sinners. We do things wrong. There's something in us that makes us do it. Jesus died to take away all the guilt. And today we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, his bodily rising from the dead, never to die again. There's a man in heaven waiting to welcome us, all of us who trust in him and his death for us. It's his resurrection which assures us that we'll have renewed bodies which will never die, never grow sick, never grow old. And we look forward to that with great hope. So we're going to sing a couple of songs, stand and sing together. Jesus Christ is risen today. attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be clung on to, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Thine be the glory.
So, and some others. Right. Oh, what happened there? Thank you. I think I may have pressed a button here by accident. Thank you. Thanks for putting it right. Now, Easter time. We look at things happening during the last week of Jesus' life, and I'm going to put some of them up on the screen. Now, can you tell me what you think that is? Wine and bread, yeah. Oh, I have to say, on Monday I showed this picture to some people in one of the care homes I work, and they said, well, I know one of them's a slipper. Like, yeah, I didn't do that picture very well. Anyway, you got it. So I want to know, where does that bread and wine, one of the children, where does that fit into the account of what happened at Easter? Yeah? The Last Supper. And which day of the week did the Last Supper take place? Not quite, although it's an interesting one because it could technically be true, because for a Jew, Friday started at 6 o'clock in the evening. And if the Last Supper was after 6 o'clock, which it would have been, then technically it is actually on the Friday. So it's actually a really good answer. For us, it would be Thursday, but for a Jew, it would be Friday. So interesting. The day when Jesus was pointing them to the sacrifice that he would make later on that day, day of Passover. Now, you might be thinking, I may have got the wrong season here. What's the donkey got to do with the last week of Jesus' life? Yeah? Jesus rode on a donkey. And where was he going on the donkey? Right answer. Very good. Do you know where he was going? Jerusalem. Very good. He rode into Jerusalem, and that day all the crowds said, Hosanna! The one who saves is coming. Save! Come and save us. They were so excited. That was like last Sunday. Right? By Friday, what were they shouting? Anyone know what they shouted on Friday when they said, what shall I do with Jesus? Pilate said, what shall I do with Jesus? And what did the crowd say back? Do you remember? Crucify him. They changed from, come on, come to be the one who saves, to get on that cross. We want you dead. How awful. Okay, easy one coming up. Although, to be honest, didn't work very well yesterday, did it? I had no idea what it was. What do we reckon that is? Come on, someone, anyone? What do you think it is?
A tomb.
A tomb? And how many? And who's in the tomb?
Jesus.
Actually, not anymore. But good answer. He would have been on the Saturday, but by Sunday morning, he's gone. Great answer, thank you. Yeah, so that's what we celebrate today. An empty tomb. He certainly was in the tomb. He was definitely dead. But on Easter Sunday morning, he was risen. So what's the one that's missing? What is the one that's going to come up next? There is sort of one thing. Yeah, go on then. I didn't hear the first answer. Do you want to give me one? The cross. Yeah, the cross. Okay, so can someone put them in the right order for me? Can someone put them in the right order for me? Come on then. Sorry? The Last Supper. Oh, you're going to have another go? The donkey. Yeah, Jesus coming into the... Yeah, so, yeah, that's first then. And then the cross, and then the tomb. Okay. Oh, I'm so disappointed. That was meant to animate. We've obviously not got the right version of whatever. Anyway, there you go. So that's right, they're all in the right order. You see, Jesus came for people who, like his people had throughout the ages, there were times when they worshipped God, they were true to him and they followed him, and there were times when they were just awful. Oh, we have good days and bad days, but do you know, the Bible says even the best things we do them for the wrong reasons. We've got sinful hearts. And like those people who one day were saying, come and save us. And 4 to 5 days later, they were saying, we want you dead. We are crazy, mixed up, sinful people. And even the best things we do are not good. But Jesus died to take away our sins. And Jesus rose again to prove that everything he said and did and is true. It's a lovely thing to know that there's a man risen in heaven just waiting to welcome us all to join him forever. New bodies. I won't have a bump on the head, which I had yesterday. There won't be problems like that. It'll be a wonderful place to be with Jesus forever. Let's sing again. See what a morning gloriously bright in Jerusalem. Stand and sing.
Each Easter we have a special offering, and this year it's David is going to explain where that offering goes. Now, we're not going to take bags around, but there is a bag at the back if you'd like to contribute to this. And for regulars here, you know the different ways you can give.
Yeah, this is just really an update for those that weren't around last week, for our visitors or those that weren't at the members' meeting. Exceptionally, the Easter offering is for the Bible Society. The reason why we as an eldership chose it is because they are still working in Gaza. There's a team in Gaza. They've got two offices. They've both been damaged, bombed, shelled. Two of their members of staff have been injured in that, and yet they're still working, sharing the good news, sharing the Bible to the suffering people in Gaza, as well as carrying on their work in Jerusalem and Nazareth, doing great work there, sharing God's word, God's truth, God's hope, God's light, the gospel with those who desperately need to hear it in such a fractured society, with so many tensions there, sometimes bubbling under the surface, sometimes bubbling over, as you know, in the Middle East there. So as Phil said, there are bags at the back, or if you need to speak to me or Jeff about other ways of giving, I think it'll be open this week and until next week for the Bible Society work, particularly in Gaza. Thank you.
Right, well, let's pray for that and for other matters. Father, we thank you that this time of year we can remember all that Jesus has done for us, incredible sacrifice that he made, the opportunity we have in believing in him. That's all, believing in him, trusting in his death and his resurrection for our forgiveness and our new life that we gain so much that he deserved comes to us. And we thank you for this time of year, and we worship and praise you for the wonderful gift of the Lord Jesus. Thank you that he came to bring peace, peace between God and man. Thank you for the work of the Bible Society and the way that they are endeavouring through their work to have the Christians on both sides of the national divide to be united in the Lord Jesus. And we do thank you for that work that's going on even now, both in Gaza and in parts of Israel. And we thank you for the fact that they have managed to stay on doing that despite having their places bombed and damaged. Oh, Father, we thank you for them. Keep them safe, protect them, and may that wonderful message of hope and unity and salvation be proclaimed clearly by them in that sad and difficult situation. Father, there are other conflicts around the world. We're so conscious of the long conflict now in Ukraine. And Father, we pray for great wisdom to be brought to leaders around the world, for compassion, for justice to be done, for peace to be a quick outcome there. Father, thank you that you are in control of every situation. And Father, we think closer to home. We pray for our government at this time, for our king, for the royal family. Father, may they govern diligently. May they set a good example. May people who have that wisdom that comes from your word also have the ear of those who guide and lead us. So we pray this not because we deserve it as a nation, but because we ask for your mercy on our nation. And so, Father, we bring you our prayers in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, Caleb's going to come and read to us. Joshua's been working through the Gospel of Matthew. He's jumped forward right towards the end. So it's Matthew 28. Have you got the page number for us?
Yes, it's on page 1000, exactly.
1000, okay.
So it's Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. So that's on page 1000 in the Church Bible. The Resurrection. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you're looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the woman hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his hands, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me."
Well, just before Pastor comes to speak to us from that passage, we're going to sing again, What is Our Hope in Life and Death? And our hope is solely in Jesus. And at the end of this, if the younger ones would like to go out to their activities, head for that corner and you'll be told what to do.
Christ, our hope in life and death. Oh, sing, hallelujah. Thank you, Phil, for leading us this morning. Before we get started, let's go once again in prayer to our Lord. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you today. Whether we have come intentionally or unintentionally, we come before you now and we sit under your word. And Lord, we are ready to hear it. And if we're not, Lord, may you make us ready. By your Spirit, may you teach us the things that we know not and make us the person that we are not, so that we may glorify you. God, we thank you for this means of grace, your word of God. And Lord, as we study it this morning, may those of us who know you be strengthened by it, and those of us who don't come to know you by it. And so we pray and ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. The Apostle Paul opens his letter to the church in Galatia with this greeting. He says, "Grace to you and peace from our God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ." And then he says, "Who gave himself for our sins to deliver us from this present age, evil age, according to the will of our Father, of God our Father, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen." And when we think of Easter, and when we've been thinking about this last week, we rightly focus on the death of Christ upon the cross. And Paul, as he writes that letter to the church in Galatia, he is saying that everything he is about to write to this church is grounded first and foremost in the knowledge of what Christ has accomplished. And furthermore, we as a church, this is our foundation, that Christ has accomplished the means of our salvation through the death, burial, and resurrection. And there would be no salvation, no church, and absolutely no reason to carry on in this fashion apart from the truth that Jesus sacrificed his life upon the cross for the sins of the elect. Christ's death is vitally important then. It is important, for it is the only payment that the Father would receive for the wages of your sins. And it took the giving of Jesus' perfect life, and it took the shedding of his blood in order to provide the remission for all those who believe. And we celebrate this truth every single time we partake of communion at the Lord's table. We are reminded by that means of grace of what he's done and our participation in receiving it. It reminds us of Christ's sacrifice, and it strengthens our resolve to press on toward the mark. The mark is our future glorification. But let me submit to you that Christ's victory over death and the grave, his resurrection, that which we worship and we celebrate today, plays just a vital role in our salvation and in our hope for the future. Yes, without his death, we would have no hope, but nor would we have hope if he wasn't resurrected. You see, anyone can be martyred for what they believe. Anyone. And the death of a martyr can have a huge impact on those that follow in their footsteps. But let me make very clear to you today that Jesus was no martyr. You see, martyrs stay dead, but Jesus did not. He is our Savior and God, and in fact, he promised time and time again that he would rise again. In Matthew 17, verse 22 and 23, it says, "As they were gathering in Galilee, Jesus said to them, 'The Son of Man,'" referring to himself, "'is about to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill me.'" And then he says, and he will be raised on the third day. Now you might rightly ask, why did Jesus need to be resurrected? Why did he need to be raised from the dead? Well, that's a great question. I'm glad you asked. But I think it's a question that I think some Christians don't even have an answer to. They know he died, they know he was resurrected, but they have no idea why it's important. You see, Christ's resurrection proves that he himself was not a sinner. In fact, God's raising Christ from the dead is his declaration that his son is perfectly righteous. Death could not hold Jesus forever because Jesus was not a sinner himself. And God's wrath on our sin was exhausted upon him upon the cross. The Father raised his son from the dead because perfect justice demanded that death cannot hold on to a person when there is no sin present. You and I die and we stay dead, particularly for eternity, if Christ hasn't covered our sins. But because Christ had no sin, it wasn't just for him to remain dead. He had no sin of his own. And there was no sin left to be punished once Christ's work on the cross was over. So Jesus' resurrection was a necessity. And we know that God accepted Christ's payment for sin and that Christ is perfectly righteous because Jesus rose from the dead. And thus we know that trusting in Jesus alone will save us. And it's so important to understand why Jesus must be raised from the dead. But I wonder how many listening in this room or listening on YouTube or might be saying to themselves, yes, that's all well and good for you religious folks, but miracles cannot and do not happen. Because anyone who is dead and is raised again, that's a miracle, and miracles cannot happen. You cannot break the laws of nature. Some will say the resurrection of Jesus is a fairy tale made up to build up and to validate the message of a man who was just a man. That's what many in the world say today. And we as Christians, those who believe and those who are worshiping today for that reason, we ought to have an answer. We ought to have a defense. If the resurrection isn't worth defending, then what are we doing? The question of the validity of miracles is one that deserves a reasoned answer. And by the way, if you have other questions about that, I'd be happy to sit down with you. But the best way I know to give an answer to the miracle of the resurrection is simply to say, examine the evidence. You see, because I would say that if the resurrection truly took place, then miracles can and do happen. And then you have to take seriously everything that the Bible says. In fact, the resurrection, the truth of it, is the bedrock, the foundation upon which our faith is laid. Examine the evidence. I want you to think about for a moment the basic facts of this supposed miracle. First, I want you to understand there are some basic foundational facts. First, every single historian and respected documentarian of the time, I'm talking about Josephus, Tacitus, Lucian, the Talmud, and all the Gospels, every single one of them agree that Jesus of Nazareth died via Roman execution upon a cross. Now, many people say, well, Jesus didn't actually die. He was punished, and then he came down, and he snuck away, and he lived out a regular life. But that is not what history tells us. Secondly, consider that Jesus' disciples, I mean, hundreds of them, believed that Jesus appeared before them in person after he died and after he rose. Again, they not only claimed to see him, but they built their belief upon it. And many, many, many people were martyred because they would not change their belief about the resurrected Christ. Third, Paul, the Apostle Paul, who vigorously persecuted the early church, had a monumental change in his life. He went from killing Christians to being the greatest leader of the church. Fourthly, James, the half-brother of Jesus, who was an outspoken skeptic of Jesus' messiahship. And by the way, who wants to believe their brother is the Messiah? Right? He had that working against him. Nevertheless, James also experienced a great monumental change in his life. He went from being a doubter to being a leader, a pastor, an elder in the church in Jerusalem. And lastly, and the thing that we're going to focus on the most this morning, is that there is no argument that tomb was not empty. Everyone agrees, historians alike, whether they be Christian or non-Christian, believe that the tomb was empty. Now, of course, none of these facts, including the empty tomb, proves on its own the resurrection. But if you put them together, you would have to put your fingers in your ear and say, la, 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 and ignore these facts to uphold your belief that the resurrection didn't happen. You'd have to just ignore the facts. People who say, well, it doesn't meet the science. They're not being very scientific if they ignore these minimal facts of the reality of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Well, I want to look at that last fact, that the tomb was empty. This morning we're going to examine three items. First, we're going to look at the discovery, then the message, and the command. So let me read those first four verses to you again. Now, after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. Now we come to this scene. Jesus is dead. He's been laid in the tomb. His followers would still be grieving his death. You don't get over grief in a day. They would still be distraught. They would still be worried. They would still be wondering what is happening. And of course, after his crucifixion, he's laid in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. And the two Marys come with spices and wanted to see the tomb. This was apparently, or could be, that because the burial was done in haste on the Friday, that there would still be some things that needed to be done with the body. It is not certain that the women would even have been allowed to complete their tasks by the guards. And also, we must remember that Nicodemus had already used a large quantity of spices at the burial. And so perhaps the Marys just simply needed an excuse to go to the tomb to see the body of Christ. But Matthew states that this occurred after the Sabbath. Now, as Phil was kind of explaining there, it's not speaking necessarily that they went immediately as soon as the Sabbath started, but probably a little bit of time, a little bit into the day, they went to visit. When it became dawn, they had gotten up. When the light was coming up, when the sun was coming up, and they went to see the tomb. But as they approached the tomb, I mean, how many of you have visited? I'm not big into visiting gravesides, okay? My loved ones who know Christ are not there. It's just a headstone. It's just a memory. If that's something you like to do, by all means, do that. But if you were to visit a graveside and an earthquake happened and an angel appeared, That would probably be outside of normal activity. But that's exactly what happened to these women. As they approached the tomb, there was a great earthquake. I don't know if you've ever felt the effects of an earthquake, but it's quite unsettling. I've only ever felt a very slight movement of the earthquake one time, but nevertheless, when it shakes, it grabs your attention. Well, this, to say the least, halted their plans. Further still, the discovery of an angel of the Lord descending from heaven was something quite remarkable. You go there to see the deceased, and the earth shakes, and his angel descends from heaven. Now, each gospel writer records this scene slightly differently. Matthew has one angel. Mark speaks of a young man sitting on the right side. Luke has two dazzling people, two men in dazzling clothes, while John refers to two angels in white. But it seems clear that all the references are to angels, and the small differences are not really that big of a deal. But in any case, the important thing to note is that the women were stalled and startled in their visit by this angel. In verse 3, Matthew gives further description of the angel. He says that his appearance was like lightning. Have you ever been out in a storm? Maybe I remember this wrong, but I don't remember having severe lightning storms. Where we grew up, it's a show. I mean, lightning is, and it flashes, and it, as a kid, it scares you to death, and then the thunder rolls. We had, growing up, like strong thunder and lightning storms growing up. And let me tell you, to see lightning flash is both breathtaking and terrifying, especially if you're a little kid. But imagine the brightness of lightning striking. And that's how Matthew describes what they saw. And then they see this figure that is clothed in white. White as snow, not an off-white, not an eggshell, but white, bright, brilliant white. Clearly, this figure was not of the earth. So remarkable was the angel's appearance that the guards trembled and became like dead men at the sight of him. Now, those of you who have been coming to our Revelation study will remember, as I remembered this week studying this, of John's response when he sees Jesus in Revelation. And it says, John says, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead." Listen, these charlatans who say that they spoke to God and sat down and have a chat with God, and they spoke to him back and forth just like you and I would speak, are not experiencing what anybody in the Bible experiences when they see God or when they see an angelic creature. It is fear and awe and almost paralyzed in the presence of even an angel, not to mention God himself. If someone says to you, "Yeah, I sat down and chatted with God last night in my bedroom." "Oh, really? What was your response?" "Oh, it was great. We had a cup of tea. We chatted for a while." You could just throw that out the window. That probably didn't happen. You know, if that happened, and I'm not saying it does anymore because we have the full complement of the Word of God, but if that were to happen, you would expect him to say, "I fell down like a dead man. I was overwhelmed." That's just my two cents there. Matthew tells us that this angelic figure rolled back the stone, this heavy stone that was covering the tomb, and he sat on it. It's important to know that this heavy stone was not rolled back so that Jesus could leave the tomb. No, friends, he was already gone. The stone was rolled back so that the women could clearly see that Jesus was no longer there. He who you came to see is not there. He's not there. This was the greatest of discoveries, and surely not at all what the women expected to find. The tomb was empty, and Jesus made it very clear that he would be raised to life. And yet discovering the absence of Jesus' body was a shock to them. Listen, have you ever read the Bible and you think, David preached the other week about walking on the water. They had just seen the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000, and yet they're awestruck by the next miracle that Jesus performed. And you think, why don't these people get it? Well, we're all like that. We have to be told time and time again. Listen, as a pastor, I have said the same things to the same people, helping them overcome a certain sin or a certain problem again and again and again. So sometimes these things are not common sense to us, and particularly when we have such a shock and awe of seeing an angel and the tomb opened up, they were forgetting what Jesus had told them, that he would rise again. And so there was the proof. The Marys may have worried that someone had stole the body of Jesus. That might have been their first thought. Imagine this discovery brought to them great fear and great confusion. They see this empty tomb. They see Jesus' body gone. Their first inclination is not to say, well, he's been risen again. But I would imagine their first inclination is, who took the body? And yet that is the very reason why the angel has a message of comfort for them. And that's the very next thing that we're going to look at this morning, is the message. Now look at verse 5 and 6. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen. As he said, come see the place where he lay." The angel was certainly aware of the fright that overwhelmed them by seeing him, by seeing the empty tomb, and yet he focuses on comforting these women. He could see their fear and confusion, and so he says, "Do not be afraid." He knew exactly why these women came to the tomb. They were seeking Jesus, who had died, who had been crucified. And the undeniable truth was that Jesus had died. Though he had warned his followers that he must die, it is very likely that when he actually died, it was hard for them to believe it. When you lose someone, it's hard to believe that they're actually gone. When our loved ones die, it does take some time to accept the reality of their death. And there would likely have been a mixture of emotions swirling around in the minds and hearts of all of Christ's followers. But the angel makes an undeniable statement of fact. He says that Jesus is not here. It was Jesus, or at least the body of Jesus, that these women came to see, but he was not to be found in the tomb. And there was a reason for this. Jesus was not in the tomb because he had risen. He had come back to life. It was as if the angel was attempting to alleviate their fears of what might have happened. The angel gives this reason for his absence. He's not here not because someone stole him. He's not here because he faked his death and he slipped out in the night. No, he's not here because he had been risen again. He was no longer dead. He was not dead, but he was risen. Jesus had risen just as he had told them he would do. You see, God cannot lie, and Jesus is God. And so when he said he would rise again, that's what he meant. The death of Christ on the cross had not been the end of him. Maybe his followers did not fully understand or believe what Christ said when he promised that he would be raised again to life. But here was the evidence, right there in front of them. Imagine if they had found the tomb empty with no angelic messenger to confirm what they were seeing. I'm sure that speculation would have overrun the disciples of Jesus, and it would have been possible to have created great division among them. And yet God saw fit to provide very clear, undeniable evidence of Christ's resurrection and a clear message of what had taken place. There would be no confusion about what took place that night. Jesus had been raised from the dead by the Father. And because Jesus had been resurrected, it means that we will be as well. His resurrection was meant to fulfill Scripture, to provide our salvation, to defeat death, and to guarantee our resurrection. Paul highlights that last reason when he wrote in 1 Corinthians 15. He says, "But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive." The message we've been wonderfully given is, "He is not here, for he has risen." And lastly, the command. The angel gives the women, these Marys, a command. "Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell the disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid." There's that phrase again. "Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." So the angel gives the Marys this command, go and tell. The message of the risen Christ is not to be kept to ourselves. If you are here this morning because you were invited by a friend, or because you received an Easter Sunday invitation, please know that we want you to hear this message as well, that Christ is risen. Jesus is not dead, but he is risen from the dead. The angel also tells the women that he's going to be there, going before them to Galilee. This is in direct connection to a promise of Jesus. Jesus promised in Matthew 26, verse 32, "But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." See, this wasn't new information. They already had it. But they're told again. And before the women would even arrive, before they would even arrive to tell the good news to the other disciples, Jesus would already be there. Can you imagine what these women experienced? We get a glimpse of what they felt as Matthew tells us they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy. When you are excited and you're pumped up with adrenaline, you can accomplish physical feats that normally might not be difficult for you. You know, you hear of mothers lifting cars off of their children and so forth. That adrenaline can do great things. I would imagine that the women had walked to the tomb, but when they left, they ran to tell the disciples. What a spiritual and physical high they must have felt after receiving this command. When you have good news to share, do you keep it to yourself? Or do you share it? Thank you, Terry. The money's in the mail. No, you don't keep it to yourself. You don't. You share it. And many of you in this room claim to be Christians, but you keep the message of the gospel to yourself day after day after day. We must proclaim the good news, just as the Marys were compelled to do. Their legs could not carry them fast enough. They had to tell. They had this amazing encounter with an angel and were told to deliver the message of Jesus' resurrection. And what in the world could ever top that experience? Right? What could be better than that? And yet things would only get better for these women. Soon after they began their run, they are confronted, they are greeted by Jesus himself. When they were confronted by the angel, they were afraid. They were fearful. But when they saw Jesus, their response was to worship. And Matthew tells us that they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Whatever doubts, whatever fears, whatever confusion they may have felt was gone in an instant. They fell at his feet and they worshiped him. The angel had told them of Jesus' resurrection, but before them stood the proof of the promise. They could see him. They could touch him. And what the angel had told them was confirmed, without a doubt. What can we do but fear and worship the Lord in his presence? In Revelation, an angel is recorded saying, in Revelation 14:7, and he said with a loud voice, "Fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made the heaven and the earth, the sea and the springs of water." What can we do but fear and worship him, fall down at his feet when we're in the presence of God? His sight is awe-inspiring. And the women had a chance to interact with Christ, but there was still a job to do. They still were to go and to tell. They still had to go and to tell. And Jesus says, he reminds them, go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and they're going to see me there. He might have thought, they may not believe these women, but you tell them to go to Galilee, I'm going to meet them there like I've already said. And I will prove to them that I am alive. As I've mentioned, this command is still in large part, the command we have today. Christ is risen from the grave, and we must go and tell. Jesus' final words echo this type of command. In Matthew 28:18, he says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." This is the message that every Christian has today: to proclaim the gospel, to proclaim the resurrection. Christ has died for your sins, and he has been risen victoriously over death, providing the means of new life for everyone who believes. The Bible tells us in Romans 10:9-10, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. You see, there's a lot of people out there. They believe in God. They say Jesus was a wonderful prophet. He may have even been the Son of God, but they're skeptical. But they'll say, well, the resurrection doesn't matter. Or he's just a man. No man comes back to life. And then they'll still call themselves a Christian. But you see, without belief in Christ, that God raised him from the dead, the very thing that we worship him today because of, without belief in him and the fact that he is born again, raised again to new life, raised again, sitting at the right hand of the Father, if we don't believe that in the resurrection, we don't believe in Christ at all. And there is no salvation for us. That is how vital that the resurrection is. It is all that we said it is. And this is the message for me and for you today. Let me ask you this. Have you ever lost a loved one? A parent? A spouse? Grandparent, a friend, or maybe even a child. Can you remember that moment when you found out the news? When my mother died, it's been nearly 10 years now. It was the hardest, deepest, most painful emotion that I have ever felt. I remember being in the room with her, with my brother and sister, and my brother-in-law was there, and my dad was there. My dad is a medic, and he was listening to her heart through the stethoscope? Yeah. And he was listening to her heartbeat. And she had suffered severely brain cancer, and she was just a shell of herself. And we just were encouraging her to just go home. Just go, let go, Mom. We were all there, she could hear us. And I remember my dad telling us, She's just, her heart has just beat the last beat. And it was tough. And I have to confess that afterward, the grief was so hard that it was hard to breathe. It was like the air had been sucked out of the room. And it was hard. It was really hard. Saying farewell to important people in your life is one of the most difficult things that we have to do in this life. But I'll tell you what, you know what made losing my mother bearable? Do you know why we encouraged her on her deathbed when we wanted more minutes with her to let go and go home and be with the Lord? Do you know why I was ultimately happy for her in her passing? Because I knew that she knew and loved her Savior Jesus Christ. Because Jesus promises salvation for all who believe upon him. Because he promises that for those that love him, the moment they die, they will immediately be in his presence. Because Jesus conquered death, and he conquered the grave, and he is now sitting at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for all those who believe in Christ and his resurrection. Why? Because Jesus is risen. And because he is risen, we who are in Christ will be raised up to him. That's why the Bible says, for those of us who know Christ, we grieve differently. I miss my mother every day. I feel it. It's changed my life. But she's with God. And she's there because she believed in a Christ who had power over death and the grave. And that's hope. That's the promise. That is the promise of eternal life. And many of you who are listening, and maybe some of you in this room, when you die, there is no hope. And your family members will grieve you, not in the hope of ever seeing you again. They will grieve you not with any hope. Because there's only hope in Jesus Christ. And I know these are hard things to hear. And I know some of you have lost people who did not have faith in Christ. And that makes it so much harder. But this is the truth of life and death. This is the truth of eternity. But praise be to God that he has made a way through his Son, Jesus Christ. Yes, through his death. Yes, through the shedding of his blood. But yes, because he was raised again. And anyone who believes in him needs not fear death, because Christ has conquered death. And we could say it is not death to die for those of us who know Jesus Christ. If Jesus wasn't resurrected, then there is no hope for any of us. But the truth is, he was. And if you are outside of Christ today, stop denying him. And believe in him today. Recognize that you are a sinner. Understand that Christ died to pay the debt that your sin brings. Believe then in Christ and believe that he will save you from those sins. And when you've done that, when the Spirit has done that work in you of belief, then you can know your relationship with God the Father is restored. And then you can have a guaranteed hope of the promise of eternal life with him in heaven. Our souls go on forever. And some of us who believe in Christ will enjoy eternal life. And those of us outside of Christ will enjoy, not enjoy, but suffer eternal death. And I'm here to say to you today that Christ is risen. He is risen. He is risen. And you can be too, risen out from the bonds of sin and promised eternity with Him in heaven. The question is, what will you do this morning? What will you do with this information? If you're a Christian, this is the message that you need to be proclaiming. When you go and have a meal with your family today, when you have a dinner tonight or whatever, you need to proclaim with love and grace and mercy the resurrected Christ. And if you do not know Christ today, you need to respond. Respond in faith today. Dear Lord, we pray to you now, asking that your word would not return void, that your Spirit would do his work right now in the hearts and lives of those who are sitting here today. May we as Christians respond by proclaiming the good news, and may those who are outside of Christ respond with belief. Oh, Spirit, would you draw them to salvation this morning, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. Please stand with me as we sing this last song. I think it'll really resonate with our thoughts this morning.
Sure.
that you would come awake, that you would awaken to the good news of Jesus Christ this morning. And if something has, if you have a question about something that was said this morning, if you'd like to know more about why Jesus is vitally important to your life and your eternity, I pray that you'd come and speak to myself, come speak to Phil or someone else that you might know, someone you maybe have come with. And so we pray this morning that you would go and leave in the grace of Jesus Christ.